is the feeling. Take me to the garden. I wanna feel my belonging.
Coming up in the Garden of Eden tonight.
You are welcome in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor this Sunday evening. How was your day? Tell the marriage anchor, how has your day been? What are you doing, husband and wife? What have you been up to? In the Garden of Eden, we are excited. As always, I tell you that every time I come on your TV set, I'm excited. I'm anticipating what we are going to do, what we are going to teach, especially this season. As you have noticed, things have changed. I no longer come here by just me, by myself, and teach. These days I have opened up the Garden of Eden to bring people of experience, people that we look up to, people that we admire, our fathers, mothers, instructors, mentors, leaders, people that we look up to, people that have experiences in different areas in life. They come and share their life experiences, people of knowledge, of expertise, patriarchs in different departments, in different spheres of life, and yes, they come and share what they have learned, how they've been able to reach the places they are up to, so that once they share with us their story, we are able to walk into their footsteps, and who knows, we might also be able to reach where they are at. And of course, that is the reason why this show always comes to you every Sunday evening, to journey you into a place of returning to the perspective or mind of God. And this particular episode, I am humbled, I am honored, I'm excited that the person that is here is very special to me, he's very dear. The last time I told you guys that I was about to kneel on the show, and I told you why I was about to kneel down, because my mother-in-law was in the Garden of Eden. So you just guess now who is here. My father-in-law, he's here in the Garden of Eden. Before I mention his name, this person that we have brought for you today is a reverend, he's a canon, he's a doctor, he's a mathematician, he's a scientist, he's an administrator, he's an evangelist, and yes, he's a columnist in one of Uganda's leading daily, and yes, he's none other than the former Vice Chancellor of Uganda Christian University. Doctor, you're welcome in the Garden of Eden.
Oh, thank you very much, and good evening, viewers.
It is a pleasure to have you. I am humbled.
Thank you.
I want to kneel down, but if I go down on my knees, the mic might get better. It is acceptable. It is acceptable, but we are humbled to have you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for honoring our invitation.
Thank you.
So, people that are watching us for the very first time, I mean, I've tried to do a brief of who you are. So, would you please take a minute and introduce yourself?
Well, yeah, very good once again just to be here. And for those who are listening, just to say my name has already been said. I usually introduce myself as
Actually,
John
Senyonyi. Actually, I didn't say the name.
I'm John.
Because you're my father, you're in the capacity of my father-in-law, I stopped at doctor because, you know.
Yeah, I'm John Senyonyi. And yes, I'm retired. I was doing administration work for many, many years.
Okay.
I was actually at Uganda Christian University for 20 years.
Yes.
But as far as calling is concerned, I always say I'm an evangelist.
Okay.
But also, just to say something about myself academically, where I come from.
Yes, please.
I started out indeed as a mathematical statistician. That's what I studied up to PhD level.
Okay.
And then following that, I taught at Makerere University for some time. Then in 1988, I left and I went into evangelistic work. with the African Evangelistic Enterprise.
Okay.
And I did that for 13 years at the same time, then did theological training in the United States,
okay,
where I got my master's for that.
Okay.
Then after that, in 2001, I started working with Uganda Christian University.
Okay.
Starting out as university chaplain and rising through the ranks until I became vice chancellor.
Wow, that's wonderful.
Something that I thought would never happen.
Okay.
When it comes to family, because I always like talking about my family, of which I'm extremely proud. I'm married to Canon Dr. Ruth, and I'm glad you hosted her.
Yes.
Canon Dr. Ruth Senyonyi, she's a counseling psychologist or counselor.
Mm.
She's also retired. Mm. I mean, having worked in Bank of Uganda for 22 years.
Are you retired?
Well, retired,
when people
but...
people say retired, it is
like
you're not really retired, but because you're very active. It was very difficult for us to get you here.
Well, I find myself very busy right now, to
yes,
be honest.
Yes, you are.
Very busy. Mm. But it's a happy busy,
okay,
if I can put it that way.
Okay.
It's a good busy, and I love it.
Mm.
That now it's no longer the stressful busyness that I was involved in.
Mm.
But right now I'm busy with what I would want to do.
Okay.
And I do only what I want to do.
Okay.
Whether it's preaching, writing, spending time with the family.
Okay.
We come together every now and then and we spend time traveling a little bit as well.
Okay.
So I find myself very busy. And to be honest, I don't think I would want to go back into this daily routine of work where you wake up very early, go to work, come back late in the evening. No. That's gone. But I'm also the proud father of four children.
Okay.
And the firstborn, Sarah, is married to Arthur. They all completed their education. They completed university.
Okay.
And two of them have master's degrees now.
Mm.
So Sarah is married to Arthur.
Mm.
And they've given us four amazing grandchildren.
Wow.
Four amazing grandchildren that I love spending time with.
Mm.
Then those live in Uganda and they work.
Mm.
Then we do have John Paul Senyonyi with his wife, Elle. They have two children. They both live in the UK where he's working.
Okay.
He's an architect and actually designed our retirement house.
Wow.
So, which is wonderful just to see that.
Mm.
The third born, Benjamin, is married to Anita.
Yes.
And they've been married now, they are coming to 2 years.
Mm.
And very, very lovely couple.
Okay.
And although they live here, actually Benjamin works, should I say, in Spain,
okay,
but works from here remotely.
But, okay.
He's a computer scientist. His wife is a lawyer.
Mm.
I didn't say the professions for the others, but all of them have their professions.
Okay.
Then the last born, Matthew, is the only one who is not married.
Yet.
Yet?
Mm-hmm.
Indeed.
Mm.
Oh, I look forward to that time.
Yes.
When you'll be married and give me more grandchildren.
Uh-huh.
Now, Matthew lives in Germany. He did his university education in Germany.
Mm.
He's, I think to simplify it, I would say engineer, but actually it's a bit more complicated. He told us that he's what they call an analytical engineer.
Mm.
Don't ask me what that means.
The difference from an ordinary engineer that we know?
Yes. It has to do with the data engineering.
Okay.
So essentially it helps large corporations organize their data. That's what I understand.
Oh.
But it's a lot more complex than what I'm saying.
Mm.
So, and from what I understand, I think he kind of works with one client at a time. So that's how involving the work is.
Okay.
But he's the young man, and we are very proud of him. They usually come, all of them come home during Christmas time, okay. And we spend time together. We enjoy each other's company.
That's beautiful.
So that's who we are in terms of family. We live in Mukono, on Mukono Hill.
And we are happy to have you in the Garden of Eden.
Thank you.
We get into tonight's topic, when I was doing this research, I had to do some background research on who you are besides what I already know. So my team, one of the people that is on my team, my research team, they told me that actually before he came the Vice Chancellor of UCU or Uganda Christian University, they offered him a position as a bishop in the Mukono diocese, and he turned it down and he opted to apply for the post of the Vice Chancellor. Is that true?
No, I think that is inaccurate.
Okay.
I wouldn't say I was never asked, but it is inaccurate to say I was asked to become a bishop of the... I don't want to start identifying which dioceses.
Okay.
But yeah, the truth is I was considered, and I remember telling them that really I do not think that's my calling.
Okay.
And the issue here for me is every position that I held, especially after leaving my job in Makerere as a lecturer, I always had to ask myself, is this what God wants me to do?
Okay.
Even at the university, when I went now to be the chaplain, I knew God was leading me there. When eventually I got into administration, because I served in two portfolios as Deputy Vice Chancellor, even in those two portfolios, I had to ask God, is this what you want? Now, ironically, when it came to the Vice Chancellor, I was very reluctant, very, very reluctant.
Okay.
And I had two reasons. I'm not going to say the second one, but one of the reasons why I eventually applied had to do with my youngest son. By then he was about 14.
Okay.
And this young man, I remember I had taken my children out for lunch. And so we are seated having lunch. And this 14-year-old, youngest of his siblings, he asked me a question that knocked me down as someone who has studied theology.
Okay.
Because after he said, I don't think I'm going to apply, he said to me, why? And I said, because I don't think that's what God is leading me to. Then he asked me, how do you know what God is leading you into without applying? Don't you think God can lead you through the application? I left that place ready to make to put in the application. But essentially I was saying I would be happy if I'm not made a vice chancellor.
Wow, even after applying?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, very simply, my reason was, other than saying yes, I didn't know if it was God leading me. I had worked under the other vice chancellor, the previous one, the first vice chancellor of Uganda Christian University.
As the deputy?
As deputy for 7 years.
Wow.
He had come from the US. And I had seen the stress. I had seen the
stress,
weight.
Stress or responsibility.
Yeah, and the weight that sits on your shoulders.
Yes.
When you're vice chancellor. And I did not think I wanted to spoil that.
Okay.
Yeah. That was a big one. That was a big one. But, well, I eventually applied, and the rest is history.
Okay.
Yeah.
So tonight we invited you, as you already know, to be able to guide us in understanding the role played by higher learning of institutions or universities in shaping the choices that young people make in regard to relationships and, of course, marriage ultimately. So we have these institutions of learning that give our young people a lot of freedom. Most of us come from homes where we have not been exposed to TV, to movies. We come from villages where we don't have smartphones, no internet.
Yes.
So we come to this place with abundant freedom where you can do whatever you want without anybody, you know, cautioning you or guiding you.
Yeah.
So, and then they come and for me as a counselor or somebody that has been dealing with young people, I think this is the place where they come, some of them very innocent, very naive. Mm-hmm. There's mm-hmm. a lot of peer pressure. There's a lot that goes on at mm-hmm. universities. So in my heart, I was wondering, is there anything that the higher institutions of learning can do to regulate, to guide, mm-hmm. to mentor these young people so that they mm-hmm. they appreciate the value of dating, relationships, and then mm-hmm. marriage mm-hmm. ultimately. So mm-hmm. the very first question that we are going to handle mm-hmm. at this point is basically, at what stage, let's start just from the beginning, at what stage do you think a child should be taught the true values of dating and relationships?
Oh dear.
In the life of a child.
Yes, mm. in the life of the child. Mm. I think first of all, can I say something about yes. what you just mentioned?
Yes, please.
Because speaking honestly, you were describing the life I lived mm. in as much as it is really many years ago. Mm. Because I entered university in 1975.
Okay.
And I remember vividly, young man, you've just come out of high school mm. Where everything was regulated by rules and regulations.
Exactly, yes.
And I remember one particular rule that was on the books. I mm. don't know if it is still there. This is King's College, Budo. Mm. And the particular rule said, you will not walk, or was it you shall, but I think it said you will. Mm. You will not walk on grass unless it is actually raining.
Okay.
And for some reason of all the rules, that one I remember. Okay. I don't remember the others. Mm. I'm sure they were all reasonable, but this particular one maybe because it stood out. Mm. And what I remember is now at Budo, the teachers were watching over me. You have to live like this. There were all these rules, and I had a copy of the rules. Mm. Now all of a sudden I enter university and I just find myself with unfettered freedom.
Yes.
So what you are describing is so true. So when should we start? Mm. I would say that this is similar to what I would call sexuality education. When yes. you start? Mm. From the earliest time when a child is gaining consciousness of the surroundings and the presence of others, mm. there are little vibes that a parent passes on to indicate these people are different from you.
Yes.
And you know, I see a little bit of this with one of my grandchildren who is just over 1 year. It's very, very interesting.
Okay.
That he's got a brother and he's got two sisters. Mm. There is a bond that has been created with the brother mm. that is different from the bond he has
with the sister.
With his sisters. Mm. And you start, you watch him. And you realize there's a sense in which he notices they are girls, I am a boy. Mm-hmm. This other boy here, mm-hmm. Muganzi, mm-hmm. is my brother, mm-hmm. and he's a boy.
He's a boy.
Do you see? Mm-hmm. And that needs to be reinforced from that stage. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we think these children are dumb. They are mm. not. Mm-hmm. They are already seeing that these people are different.
Exactly.
In any case, they see you dress differently.
Exactly.
Right? Mm-hmm. So when it comes to things like, will he see his sisters bathing? Mm. Well, that has to be, the boundary needs to be put
yeah,
there.
From the very beginning.
From the very beginning. Mm. And let him be able to understand that these two are not bad, they are actually very good, mm. but they are different.
Yeah, true.
And that difference is not going to change at all. I mean, we live in a world which is so corrupted that people are beginning to change things.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But that difference is not going to change.
Yeah, true.
And it is important for that child to know that. Muganzi, who is six, mm. he actually looks at them, and so do the girls. They also, in fact, it's very interesting with Muganzi in mm. particular. I was very close to him, and I still am mm. Up to now. But when he was much younger, I think he must have been like two or whatever, about the time when he could now say words very clearly. And he started early. And he wants to sit on the podium. And of course, you are supposed to help him. And he wants the toilet door closed and
privacy.
You out. And you out. And I remember at one time trying to open the door, he says, "Get out."
Wow.
That's what you would say. Get out. I want my privacy. I mean,
because
we laugh about it all the time.
As an adult, you also do that. When you enter
exactly.
the bathroom, you tell him, stay outside.
Stay out. So essentially what I'm saying is, from the very beginning. Now, the information given differs, of course.
Yeah, of course.
Because as the child grows, then you give different information. According to the development stages that are happening in the life of the child.
Yes.
But we must never think that either the child doesn't understand or that the child will learn from either the peers or the teachers or whoever. And we have always been strong advocates for learning the getting the understanding of their sexuality
of your body?
From the parents.
Oh.
From the parents. And actually, research shows that children always prefer to learn from the parents.
Exactly.
And why? But there is a very important point why that is, that is, that really is vital. And the point is, when those children learn from the parents, they are not only learning the mechanics and so forth, they are also learning, assuming that the parents themselves are doing it, but they are learning the values that go with who they are.
Okay.
So it's not only teaching them to kneel and to respect others and do this.
Say sorry, please.
Yeah, yeah. It's not only that. But everything that is happening. The first school a child goes to learn about their sexuality, to learn about marriage, to learn about parenting, to learn how to work and so on, is the home.
Yeah, true.
And they learn both by the parents' instruction and the parents' role modeling.
Okay.
That role modeling may be intentional, but quite often it is unintentional because they're just looking and they're seeing. Maybe I'll give one example. One of my sons, he was, I think, about 2 o'clock. 2 years, I beg your pardon, 2 years. And in our bedroom, we had a basket where we put our dirty clothes. And this thing has never left me. So I come back from work, take off my socks to change so that I can put on sandals or whatever. And I normally would roll my socks into a little ball and throw them into the basket.
The basket.
So on this occasion, I came home, I took off my socks, and he followed me. And of course, he was greeting me and all that, and I rolled the socks into a ball. Now, just to engage with him, I said, "Can you please put my socks in the basket?" But guess what he did?
He threw.
He went close. He knew that from the distance where I was, he couldn't do it the way I would do it.
The way you would throw them and they're able to get inside.
Yes. So he moved close enough, but he actually threw.
Because you see, you know, socks, they are thrown into. You don't have to come close and put. No, you throw them.
Exactly. So, exactly. And that is the same thing with everything about training children and preparing them.
Demonstrating.
Demonstrating. That was a small thing, quite inconsequential. But I realized that I was passing on a lot of things. And I have since, of course, in retrospect, I realize how many things I passed on. But I realized that I was passing on a lot of things subconsciously. Because I was doing them.
As an adult, not minding that there's a child
watching. Including the relationship with my wife.
Exactly.
So they watch and they see, are you relating well Or you're always quarreling and shouting and fighting.
Silence treatment.
Or you're silent from each other.
They are able to notice, mommy is not talking to daddy.
They do. They do very easily. And sometimes they would ask, you know, what's happening? In fact, another example that happened with one of our children, by then we were living in the United States. And because this child was already in school, and the particular school she was attending, there was, I think there were many divorced couples.
Okay.
I mean, the parents, many of them were divorced. So I'm sure the children at school were talking about their divorced parents. So one time at home, she notices that we are discussing, it was actually a light argument. It was not even a disagreement as such where, you know, we are attacking each other. Nothing of the sort. It was just, you know, it's like you take a different opinion from what the other person is saying. And the child looked at us and asked a question. Daddy and mommy, are you going to divorce?
Yeah.
Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
And so now we had to turn to the child and start giving the assurance that no, for us, our marriage is built for good.
Yes.
We vowed till death us do part.
Yes.
So you can see, I mean, children are observing.
Yes.
Children are observing whether we like it or not. And eventually they will do exactly the way you do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so coming back to the university level, of course, given your immense experience within UCU or Uganda Christian University, as much as we don't want really to zero down on UCU to use it as a case study, we just want you to speak on behalf of higher institutions of learning.
Yes.
What do you think is the role of universities in giving the students a good outlook or a good outlook towards the values of family?
Okay. First and foremost, and I should say it's not just at university, so what I'm going to say applies really to all educational institutions. That those people that are in university become parents to the students as long as the children are in that institution. Now, one of the things that happened when we were in a university setting, because I mean, one of the good things, and I cannot avoid talking about Uganda Christian University, because that's where we really spent a lot of time in a university setting. But because Uganda Christian University was a community where we kind of knew each other, we went to church together. We met people, you just couldn't avoid it. So in a sense, we knew each other
with
so much, including the students.
The
yeah, 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 even the students.
Okay.
Yeah, together, the worship, I would be there. I would be there. And they, you know, I always made sure that I was among them. Now, one of the things that happened for us, which we never really expected, neither did we try to live it out. We heard students say, actually they said it to us, and they say, you know, you are a role model for us as a couple, because they would see us walking together and talking together and doing things together. And I realized something that is very important, that I think many people in the university positions, whether they are lecturers or administrators or whatever position they may be, they are unknowingly parents to the students. They are parents to the students. Now, many students, when they enter university, like I said, it's, you know, I think back about at the time when I entered university, they tend to think, ah, this is the time now when I don't have rules and regulations, nobody is telling me, go to the lecture, wake up, and those kinds of things. They think that. But speaking honestly, it's a very, there's that freedom that often we carry too far as people work in university.
Okay.
It's important for us to realize that whether quietly or overtly, we are actually passing on something to these students. They're observing, they're looking.
Mm-hmm.
They see how you behave. They see what you do.
Mm.
And indeed, I had students a number of times who would talk about some of the staff members and saying, you know, it's like for them, we cannot, because they see it and they know it.
Mm.
So university staff members need to understand they have become parents to these students.
True.
And it's important to talk to them.
Mm.
It's important to guide them.
Yeah, true.
It may not be in an authoritative way the way it was in high school, but what you say actually speaks to their life like authority.
Yes, true.
However gently you put it.
Mm.
And for me, that is an important thing.
Mm.
The other thing that I found very important, at least as I spent time with the students, was the importance of mentoring.
Yeah.
I actually loved mentoring young people.
Okay.
And one of the saddest things that I realized as soon as I went into university, I realized that many of the young people, particularly this generation, many of the young people in this generation, they have no role models.
Yeah, true.
They have no people they can look up to and say, that is my example.
Some of them have come from broken homes, single motherhood.
Exactly.
You know, single parenting, and they do not have a male figure to look up to.
Yes.
Others have been raised up by grandparents.
Uh-huh.
Others are struggling. Actually, they are paying their way into school.
Right.
So they have nobody to look up to, somebody authoritative whom they admire and look up to, and they want to be like.
And when you think about some of the things, let me just take, for example, politics. When we would have politics, I noticed the same thing. Many of them think politics has to be done the way people outside are doing politics. So it has nothing to do with serving the students. It has more to do with, I want to assume a position of leadership and privilege.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, true.
Do you see?
Mm-hmm.
And they forget that the responsibility, say in the guild, is a responsibility.
The service.
It is the service.
Not
to
the power.
Exactly. Now, they are looking at these people, but these people are not their role models.
Yeah.
So when it comes to standing for election, the first thing that they think of, and you can even see it even in lower schools, you have to pay. Pay these people.
To vote for you.
Now, when it comes to university, they think you have to buy alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, but what is it? Who says? You know, we are voting you into this position so that you may serve the rest of the students. So for me, mentoring them, and I mentored some guild presidents, and I'm so glad about that.
Wow.
Mentoring these students is one of the most important things. And those that took time, guild presidents, and spent time with me and were mentored by me, they ended up being very different. If they listened, well, in most cases, those would be the ones who just came to me and they said, can you please be my mentor?
Okay.
And I would meet with them as often as I could. Usually it would have been a weekly mentorship session. But we would spend time meeting, spend an hour, talk about something. I give them a kind of assignment. And I say, go and think about this. Sometimes they don't even know how to concentrate on their studies. So they really want someone who will take their hand and show them, how can I study effectively? That is also part of mentorship.
Yeah,
or maybe the character. The character. How can I resist negative peer pressure? Many of them don't know. So they live in university and they are carried by the wave of peer pressure. And you know, it's very funny, but when young people are in university, for some reason, negative peer pressure tends to carry the day.
Yeah.
It tends to carry the day. And I know that I myself, when I joined university, you're not thinking of, can I get friends who will positively
impact me?
No. I'm looking for friends with whom we can have pleasure and we can be free from rules and regulations and things like that.
What's happening? What's going on? Where's the party?
Yeah, exactly. Now, that's the life I entered with at university. So, generally speaking, you do get a lot of that. And peer pressure is really, really, very, it's seriously.
Especially, let me, sorry to cut you short. Now, when we talk about peer pressure, it's one of the things I wanted us to really dwell on and speak to these young people that, anyway, I don't want to put words into your mouth, but how should the students at the university handle peer pressure, especially if you come and you have been raised up and there are values that you believe in, to have sex until marriage. For us, we prioritize God, we have integrity, we don't do this, and you come and you reach at a space where everything is just available, it's permissible for you, you can do whatever you want. And then you have friends now that come and undo the work, the teaching, the mentoring that your parents did, and they're telling you you're fake. You know, you're not cool enough, or you don't belong here. What's wrong with where?
You're not a man.
You're not enough. Or how you don't have a boyfriend? How 20? You're still a virgin. So how should university students handle peer pressure, especially a negative influence that is undoing the building blocks that the parents have already laid?
Right. First of all, I have to let me just make this statement. You do not choose your family, but when it comes to friends, each of us chooses the friends. And maybe even talking to the parents, really, the parents need to help young people to know what kind of environment forms their character. Now, when a student joins a university, that student should immediately make a decision. They are enough. It's like you are. It's like you are in a supermarket of things you can pick from. Right? There is the nightclub, and you know, nightclub people, they like building them near where young people are.
Yes.
There are shops. There are all sorts of things. But they are also churches. You know, they are churches. And for any young person, I would say, if you are entering university, going into a church setting will win you friends that will help you to mold a better future for yourself. The other thing that many young people, I think, forget, and I've always spoken to this, choices have consequences. You know, every choice. And the way choices happen is sometimes the consequences are immediate. But more than often,
they are long-term.
Future. Their future. I have known young people coming to me and crying because they've messed up their life in a, you know, at university. They entered, they made the wrong choice. I'm not going to blame that on anyone else. It is they themselves, and they must take responsibility for that. So they make that choice, and they say, I'm going to spend my time maybe loitering in the city, which is exactly the kind of life, by the way, I started with at university. Just walking in the university, because I was at the University of Nairobi, walking the city of Nairobi until I knew Nairobi's streets more or less like the back of my hand. At that time, it was much smaller than what it is now. But I knew Nairobi. And we walked on the tomboya, koinange, what? And, you know, we walked on these streets, Kenyatta Avenue, and so forth. So we walked on these streets. So choosing who, you know, you may not be able to choose immediately, this is going to be my friend. But if you choose a place where good friendships can be formed, then you'll get friends there.
Yes.
Okay? And that happened toward the end of my first year. When now, and I, by the way, I used to go to church.
Okay.
But I had not given my life to Christ. So at the end of my first year, then I gave my life to Christ. And at that particular time, then I was more immersed and understood that church was there for me. And the friends I had before with whom I used to loiter in the city, they were still my friends. I never threw them away. But really, this new friendship dominated my life.
Okay.
And that new friendship also influenced what kind of life I lived thereafter.
Okay.
And for the remaining 2 years of my university education, they were extremely formative of what I eventually became later. That's why I say choices have consequences.
Yeah, true.
You make the wrong choices, because now I was not only attending church, but I was also involved in church activities. Now, of
you
course,
had when less it, time to loiter the streets.
And when, so I would go to the city only because there is a purpose. You see?
Yeah, yes.
I'm not going there just to walk and look and do
hang
window
out.
Shopping.
And you hang out by the street.
Precisely.
Window shopping and all that.
Window shopping. But your window shopping, you don't even have enough money in your pocket to do anything. So of what value is that? Now I could go and I know that I want to do this.
Okay.
You know? So, but also being involved in church activities then enabled me to form new friendships.
Yes.
Because of course I was working with other people. And in forming those new friendships, my character was being formed. And character, by the way, is formed mostly subconsciously.
Yeah, true.
You don't say, now I'm going to be truthful, now I'm going to be that. Yes, you may be. But if you're saying I'm going to be truthful, but you're keeping the wrong company, before you realize it, you'll be going back.
Yeah, you'll be corrupted.
Exactly. You'll be corrupted. So the young people, and I really want to speak strongly to young people. You enter university, choose your environment. What if it is a club? Maybe it is one that's philanthropic. I hear of things like Rotaract clubs and so forth. I've already talked about church, of course. And it may be some others which go maybe to help the poor, clean up, and so on. Those are better and they are more formative of a character you'll be proud of in the future. And without you knowing, they will actually be influencing your energies toward the right direction, rather than looking at girls and going from place to place, wasting your time.
Before I maybe we allow you to continue, there's this saying amongst the young people right now that church is boring. You know, Rotaract Club, it's boring. I have the freedom. I want to have a little bit of fun. I have been in prison all my life. I want to, you know, to happen, because I work with them 18, 17, and you're wondering, so how would you advise such people who believe in the fun? For they want to have fun. Church is boring. How do you advise them?
Actually, I used to think that myself, that, you know, the life in church is so restricted. There is no real pleasure. There is no real enjoyment. But it's very interesting, when I started getting involved, I could not believe that my time was so consumed with things I loved.
Okay.
Things that I grew to value. And I found most helpful.
Wow.
I would also, I think, caution, because they are young people indeed who go to church for fun. That will not benefit you as much.
Okay.
To think that I'm just going there for fun, because there is good singing. You need to go a step further and really ask yourself, what is church all about?
Mm.
You know, and that for me is what I found.
Okay.
That church is about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's about walking with God.
A relationship with Him.
A relationship with Him that's dynamic.
Yes.
And that's different. So I don't go to church because they sing very, very well.
Mm. Or the dance group.
Or the dance group. Mm. I remember, in fact, I spent, when we lived particularly in the US, that's a good example.
Mm.
But it's the same. I lived in Australia for 5 years.
Mm.
But when I lived in the US, at first I went alone, 3 months ahead of my family joining me.
Mm.
And when I got there, I got involved in a church that many young people who are looking for, you know, where there's fun they wouldn't have gone to.
Okay.
Because in the first place, even listening in the pulpit, the gentleman would preach, he's now dead, but he would preach, and I did not understand
what he was saying.
He was a very intelligent man, a graduate of Yale. For those who understand American graduates, you know, here we talk first class, second class, upper and lower second and so forth.
Mm.
There, he was a graduate, Phi Beta Kappa. That means top.
Oh, okay.
And here he was now the pastor of this church.
Mm.
And the only thing I would hear him talking about is what is happening in the left brain, right brain, left brain, right brain. I got nothing.
Okay.
I got nothing. But the question is, why did I stay there? And I remember actually even when my wife came with the kids and she asked me after the first service, why are we here?
Mm-hmm.
After listening to the pastor, why are we here? Because I'm getting nothing. Until later on, then she realized I was not there so much for fun. I was not there for whatever. But I was involved, in fact, in Bible study, which by the time of my being there, brought a difference in some of those people's lives.
Oh.
And for me, I was thankful for that.
Yeah, of course.
We eventually, for a short time, we also decided to attend another church which was more lively, which was evangelical and understood our faith and so on. But it was such a huge church. I think it was like 3,000 or I don't know how many people.
Okay.
I just got lost in it.
Mm.
And I said, I'm not going to attend this church.
Mm.
I really don't like. I like attending a church which is small, where I can be involved. Yes, I may be fed from the pulpit, but sometimes like what was happening there, for me the feeding was the care that I was showing to these
more
people.
About what you are able to give than just receiving.
Exactly. And you know, in giving you actually feed.
Yeah, true.
In giving you feed.
Yes, you grow.
So I would encourage young people, you are not going to church just because they are singing well. You are not going to church because they are dancing well, or because the sermon is a nice breaker for you every Sunday. No. That those are important. I'm not saying they are unimportant, and they are necessary, but your involvement is key.
Yes,
your involvement is key.
Mm.
If you don't get involved, the reality is you become a pew warmer.
Mm-hmm.
You sit in the pew,
yeah,
you warm it, you go out, and you're pretty much like what James
like
talks
about.
Like
how you came.
Uh-huh. You are like James, who says you look in the mirror.
Mm.
You turn away and
you forget
what you look like.
The image that you just saw in the mirror.
Precisely.
Mm.
So for me, I would encourage every young person to really get friendships in church.
In church circles.
You need to be involved. And in that particular church, by the way, in the US, they even asked me now to be the person to enter their collections.
Mm.
I didn't have much money. At the time, I actually was earning very little, not earning, but I was being paid just $300 per month. That's what we lived on as a family.
Mm.
But these people asked me to enter, and you'd see all these checks, 1,500, 1,000, and so on. And you didn't have the money like that. But just doing that without taking a single coin from the basket, and it meant so much to me. Just that little service.
Yeah.
That little service. Was to me extremely important in participation. And I started a prayer group there. And so a few of us would gather every Sunday evening. And I would drive 20, 25 minutes from where I lived to come to church so that we gather. And I got involved in Bible studies. I got involved in all sorts of things. And that transformed quite a few people.
Yeah.
And I got many friends out of it.
Okay, so for you it has been more about what you can do, what you can put in, rather than just receiving. Okay, so before we take a short break, I know that our time is running really, really fast.
Yeah.
Before we take a break, there's this, maybe, let me call it a cliche, whereby the youth, our young people today, are more interested in a pleasure in every relationship they have, rather than love. They just want to have fun, especially sexual relationships. They just want to date for fun more than date for love. How can you explain that?
Well, first and foremost is to understand what I said, choices have consequences.
Yeah.
But secondly, pleasure is short-lived. It's very short-lived. I'm not going to tell them that sex is not pleasurable. It is very pleasurable. Very. So I'm not saying it isn't. And that's why people enjoy it, people do it, people enjoy it, and that kind of thing. But what does it do to you? The Bible is very, very concise and precise in what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. It says when you join the two people, you become one person.
You become one, yes.
Now, what does that actually mean? It means that henceforth, you went for pleasure, but actually the pleasure you went for has been imprinted. It's imprinted in your conscience. It's imprinted in your spirit. It's imprinted in you. I just want a young person to imagine. So you slept with this girl, let me just call her Harriet. Okay? And then you didn't marry her, you just slept with her for pleasure. Later on you end up marrying Jen. So one time you're walking on the streets in Kampala and you meet Harriet. And Harriet greets you. And what is happening in your heart? And you remember it?
Flashback.
Exactly. Because you're one. You joined yourself to that girl. And if there is a child that resulted from your sleeping with Harriet, you may not even talk about it. Someone will meet you with your Jen, the one you married now, and say, oh, by the way, how is Isaac? And Jen looks at you and says, who is Isaac? You see, child or no child, you were actually joined into one person.
Yeah, true.
And so, let us not think that pleasure is a passing phase.
That it has no consequence.
The pleasure itself may last a few moments, but it leaves consequences that are a lifetime.
Okay.
And that's what you're going to live for the rest of your life.
All right. At this point, we are just going to take a short break and we'll be back in just a moment. Stay with us.
Win 5 Hotels and Spa is a five-star iconic hotel situated in Nakasero, the heart of Kampala, with the highest spectacular view of the city. With over 250 rooms, expert chefs from Tunisia offering mouth-watering cuisines, the largest hotel events venues and gardens for conventions, the most advanced gym and spa surrounded by our indoor and outdoor swimming pools. Win 5 Hotels and Spa is a nip in world-class hospitality service with value for your money. Visit us us for Seeing is Believing, or call 0772-838-777. Win 5 Hotels and Spa, where luxury meets comfort.
Welcome back from that short break. You're still in the Garden of Eden with your marriage young, and of course this evening or this night we have hosted Reverend Canon Dr. John Senyonyi. Yes, now I have said the name. You see where I come from, you cannot say your father-in-law's name. So, Doctor, we are still discussing the role of universities as far as guiding our young people in matters of relationships are concerned. So I want to look at this prevalent situation that has been happening. As a student, I did face the same challenge when I was at university, of lecturers, authorities, administrators in the university circles taking advantage of young people, especially female. I'm not certain about, you know, the male children.
It happens too.
Take advantage of them and blackmail them into sleeping with them, sure, in exchange for better grades, yeah, or retakes, yeah, or favors of any sorts. What do you have to say about that?
Well, that's a larger question than you can imagine, because it's a question of how do you use your authority.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you have other people under your authority, you have an onerous responsibility.
Mm.
Because authority comes with responsibility.
Yeah, true.
And many people don't seem to realize that.
Mm.
First of all, I would say that a lecturer praying on the girls,
mm,
or even the boys, because it happens on the other side,
mm,
probably not as much, but it does,
mm,
is to me not only a misuse of authority, but it's the highest form,
mm,
of irresponsibility and wrongdoing.
Okay.
I would say it equals actually rape.
Mm-hmm.
Why am I saying that? Because what does rape do? Rape takes the position, albeit physical, whatever,
mm,
but takes that position of physical force. And that is the kind of authority that a rapist comes with,
mm,
and rapes the girl.
Mm.
Now, what is happening with the lecturer is not using physical force,
mm,
but is actually using the authority,
mm,
that they have,
mm,
because I have your marks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I have the power to determine whether you will pass,
uh-huh,
or fail.
And so to me, those kinds of people should not just, that's a matter that should not just be at university level. It's just, mm, a pity that in our, it stops at universities simply because,
mm,
I think our laws do not address it in the same way.
Are there no policies at the university level that handles
universities
such cases?
Do have them.
Okay.
Universities
there
do
no
have those
sexual
policies.
Harassment policies?
Yes, yes.
Are they followed through? Are they effective?
Yeah. What makes it complex,
mm,
is on the one hand the adducement,
mm,
of evidence.
Okay.
To adduce evidence is always harder,
mm,
because how do you show? These lectures just talk.
Mm. They are smarter. They also know you can, uh-huh, record them, so they will not send a text message or a WhatsApp,
exactly,
message.
And that's probably why that kind of act is not given the criminal level,
mm,
in the national laws that, mm, it should have.
Mm.
But in my conscience,
mm,
it's not different. It's not different.
Mm.
You are essentially using, the other person is using physical power, you are using the lecturer's power,
mm,
to do exactly the same thing.
Yeah, true.
To go into space that is not yours.
Mm.
You know,
mm,
to cause trauma to this young girl.
Mm.
And like I was saying before, to be united with this girl,
mm,
and therefore you are denying the person who will be her husband the opportunity to marry a girl who is pure,
mm,
and virgin for,
mm,
him.
Mm.
So I would say it's not really different.
Okay.
Now, at university, one of the things that often happens, there are policies. I do believe that at least I heard Makerere was even reviewing its policy. At UCU, we had that very clear policy.
Okay, did you have such cases come out while you were vice chancellor?
Not really, but there were some, like I said, adducing evidence is usually the most difficult thing.
Okay.
But I think there was so much fear.
Okay. We are told that UCU, you do a lot of policing.
Yes.
There's a denial of lots of freedoms. What you wear, you can't do lipstick. You can't. There's a lot of regulation.
Let me come to that a bit later. But I should say that I think the other thing that was very clear, because we are a community, if a lecturer did anything like that, it would soon be in the public space.
Yes.
You see? It would soon be in the public space. And people, and there was a lot more freedom for students to actually say that, hey, this is happening. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Good.
There's a lot, there was a lot more opportunity. So it's not like, and sometimes that comes when the distance between the authorities and the students is reduced. And then they are able to see that when a student feels, administration is not up in the sky and I can't approach it, but I can actually go to administration at any time. And I think that really helped. Now, talking about what you are saying about the regulations, about how you dress and so forth, I think it also comes in. The reality is there are cases, and we had lecturers actually report or even exercise authority over, and this is mostly girls, and the lecturer is sitting in front. The girl makes sure that they are putting on, of course, when they enter, they are putting on a dress that is acceptable, and then they pull it
so
back.
So before they enter the lecture room, you have a certain height of the dress.
Yeah, wow. And it's covering them well. Then all of a sudden they pull it back so that the lecturer can see.
So you see? Students also strategically, or they also harass.
Of course, that also happens. Now, in that is really, and that's where the lecturer now should draw the line very immediately. And for the lecturer, it is important to handle the issue immediately. Immediacy saves you a worsening situation.
Yeah.
Because if you allow this girl, when she sits like that, I do hope it's not innocently. But when she sits like that and is trying to tantalize you with her thighs, essentially she's inviting you. And so you yourself must immediately draw the line very clearly. And that's what UCU did.
Okay.
It's very simple. So if a girl is moving around the university, you did not come to spend your time on Nile Avenue. You came there to study.
Yeah.
Right? And if you came there to study, we want you to put on an appearance that truly focuses on what brought you there.
Okay.
To be a learner who will come out more holistically formed than to be a learner who is attracting, and it may not be just the lecturers, but also the boys. That's not acceptable.
Okay, maybe to just emphasize a little bit, can you emphasize on the importance of prioritization as you're pursuing your career or your dreams in life? Most young people do not know what is important or most important at what stage. So they just go with the flow. So if you can just highlight, like, if you are at the university, what is more important at that level, especially when it comes to even relationships, between academics and relationships.
I mean, first and foremost, I would say, let the young person know what brought you to university.
What is it called anyway?
It's
a place for you to come and study.
Yes. But for me, I look at what brought you to university in a broader sense. Universities form students in a lot more than just intellect. And that's what we had actually at UCU. Because at UCU, we would be talking about holistic education.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, we eventually wrote out what is a tagline now. I think I hope they still use it on their headed paper. At the very bottom, when you read, it says we offer, well, it doesn't say we offer, but says a complete education for a complete person. What brought you there was education. Now, the word university has the same root as the word universal. Comes from a Latin word, universus. And universus is about the whole. So you go to university to get a holistic education.
Yes.
Which will touch, yes, on your intellect, which will touch on physical fitness, social relations, to know how to relate with others, emotional, okay, your psyche.
Psychological.
And also spiritual.
Yes.
So it should be forming you. Let's not think that universities are supposed only to give me intellect and
good
skills.
Good grades.
Good grades. That is wrong. A university education from the very beginning was intended to form the student.
Okay.
So that when they come out, they have been formed in the way they think, they've been formed spiritually, in their relationship with God, they've been formed to look after their physical bodies and keeping them healthy, in how they're relating with others,
people.
But also psychologically, that they are able to handle pressure.
Yeah, the challenges that come.
The
with
challenges
life.
That are going to come. This is what university education is all about.
Then someone will also come and argue that, you see, that is why we have to test the waters and start dating at the university, because I'm preparing for my marriage.
You see, that is a statement.
And
that is
the excuse they always give. But I want
to test and see.
I want to get the experience.
You know, you remind me of a statement that was made to me just after I gave my life to Christ in 1976. And I went to teach in a school here in Kampala, in mathematics during my long vacation. And the teachers got to know that I was saved, and they asked me, but are you going to marry someone without tasting?
Can you imagine?
That was interesting. Now I look back and I say to myself, but are the girls there like guinea pigs in a lab? Are they guinea pigs?
To be experimented on.
For my experimentation? These are human beings of equal status with me.
Yes.
You see? I need to respect them as humans created in God's image. I need to be able to honor them, these girls. And so don't think that... if that is the mentality someone, a young person grows up with, that young person will enter marriage with exactly the same mentality. And that needs to be reformed.
Okay.
So that the young person understands that these people of the opposite sex, they are not, and I'm using opposite sex, the word gender now has been terribly watered down. That's why I say opposite sex.
Opposite sex, yes.
So these people of the opposite sex, are actually partners with me, people that are loved by God, people created in the image of God for glorifying Him.
Okay. Yeah. So before we do bring the show to a close, there's one thing that is really itching me. I do understand that different universities have got centers of wellness that deal with emotional, psychological, you know, counseling centers, services. These services are available within the university structure.
Yes.
So, but then students tend to have a sort of stigma. They fear, they want to shy away from utilizing these centers. What can you say to a student, maybe freshers that are joining university, they are coming from different schools and they are coming to these places, how can you advise them? What can you say, like in encouragement, to trust these people and to be able to seek the knowledge that will guide them, because they do not know where they are going, but these people that are helping them have been there.
My wife, who is a counselor, as you know, She actually commended UCU for having the first properly established counseling center in a university setting. Now, for many young people, the fear quite often is, I think, is twofold. That's what I see the most. I'm not saying it's the only one, but it's twofold. One, they think that a counseling center is where you go when you are in emotional turmoil. The other, they think that what I talk about with a counselor will be spread everywhere. Now, both of those are actually false beliefs.
Yes.
They are not true. You are supposed to go there to talk through your life, to be guided. And when you talk with a counselor, these people who are professionals have been trained in confidentiality.
Yes.
So I would encourage any young person, don't die in silence.
And wondering, and you're only receiving advice from your friends who also have not been where these older people have been.
Yes, 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 exactly. And that's what I used to tell actually my children when they were young. I would tell them, I'm guiding you in this because I've been where you are. You've never been where I am. I don't want you to make mistakes. So that is the authority that I come with, the sound authority of experience. Yeah.
All right, Doctor. Thank you so much for coming
thank you.
To the Garden of Eden. I really wished that we had like 2 hours. I wish we had like 2 hours really to do a part 1 and part 2. And maybe we will get time and invite you, especially in areas of parenting, because I know that you have quite an experience in that. Thank you once again for coming.
Thank you so much.
Watching the Garden of Eden TV show. Before we go, I'd like to take a minute and appreciate Win 5 Hotel Nakasero for hosting the Garden of Eden TV show, for their excellent amenities. And yes, this is the former Pearl of Africa Hotel. The management has since changed. Come check them out. Interesting things are happening. Yes, new things are happening. Forget the past experiences. Come visit if you have a function, a wedding, workshops. Hang out, eat out. I've met some of their chefs from Tunisia. So please come check them out. You will enjoy every bite of what they have to offer. It's a wrap right here in the Garden of Eden. Good night. God bless you.
Thank you for connecting to The Marriage Anchor. For more information, call us on 0702-767-602 or 0782-958-875. Email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com. Like and follow us on Facebook, The Marriage Anchor. Twitter, Anchor_marriage. Instagram, Marriage_anchor. Check our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor for all our previous episodes. The Garden of Eden, a test of heaven's romance.
Take me to the garden. I can't resist the feeling. Take me to the garden. I want to feel my belonging. Take me to the garden. I am yours.
And you are mine.
Garden.